Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance session, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Will to Love group and is part of the Education in Love series. In the Facing My Fear of Emotion presentation, Jesus discusses the importance of dealing with false beliefs about emotion, having faith in God's truth about emotions, and the need to experience and release false emotional beliefs before change is possible. Recorded on the 24th of February 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Who's the owner of this particular drive? It was in a plastic bag. It's yours, Rita. You didn't put your name on it. Can't see your name anyway, but anyway. Come and hold my hand. Is it yours? Well, it's not got a sticky taped on name. And that's what you do with me pretty much all the time. You argue with me constantly. It's like you like an argument, don't you, Rita? Some of you, that's what I feel from you. It's like, no, I don't agree. That's it. And you don't say it, but it's constantly coming at me the whole time I'm talking. No, don't agree. And I don't even know why you're here sometimes when you do that. Rita, what do you want to say? There's no mics here, I don't think.
I just
want to
say, what's the right thing be for me to think about what you're saying?
What's the right thing for me to be to think about what you say and to feel it?
No, what you need to do, Rita, is you need to look at the rage you have within you, because you're full of rage.
Okay.
Full of rage. And it's coming out of you all the time, particularly towards men.
Okay.
Particularly towards men. And it's very uncomfortable with you in any audience, to be honest.
Okay.
Because there's so much coming out of you. And you just don't want to own it. You want to fight authority all the time. So yeah. You're fighting any kind of authority. So you're obviously fighting God's authority.
Yeah.
Otherwise you wouldn't do it. But the key is to be... Well, there's one thing I want to talk to all of you about in the feedback session, actually, in the group feedback session. Because... you'll notice that there's only around 20 men here and there's 50 women. You notice that? And you ladies, you're not dealing with a lot of the rage you have towards men. You're just not dealing with it. You either want to have a man who you just totally pummel into the ground and have him do whatever you want, or you want no man whatsoever because you're just closed to the opposite gender, and it is a big problem. And most of you are in a deep facade about it, and that's a big problem for you. You're not going to have a very good relationship with God like that.
Can I ask something else? Does that mean now you think I'm lying when I said I did put a sticky tape on it?
Well, there's no sticky tape on it. So
could it maybe have fallen off?
No, but why do you even raise that? It had no sticky tape on it. All I'm asking is whose it is. All I need to do is give it to you. All I was happy to do is say, it's got no name on it, here it is, and that's it. I was happy to do that. But you want to argue about it.
Okay. It has no name on it.
It has no name on it for whatever reason. It doesn't really matter.
I understand why you say I argue, because I need to say something when I actually didn't.
You do need to say something. You always need to say something. That's the issue you have. And a lot of times it's not even necessary. I'm not condemning the person. There's been a number of drives handed in without a name on it, and all I've done is said, whose is this? It's not a major problem. But it is... when you want to argue about it. And that's what's coming from your soul all the time. You just want to argue about everything.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
And that's an indication that you believe your opinion is right all the time, which is an arrogance issue. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. All right, is everyone here or? Well, I found yesterday quite tiring. I don't know about you. There was a lot of resistance in the room yesterday. So later on in the afternoon, we'll address that in the feedback session with the group. We'll talk about why that's happening. Is that all right with you? Good day. All right. How are we this morning? Fourth day, two-thirds of the way through almost, halfway through we are right at this moment, two-thirds after this evening, and that's only, so far, of the 240 hours of our introductory course I love, you've done how many? 9 plus 5, 14 hours at this stage, 15 hours around about, yeah. Now, if you're going to be as resistive as many of you were yesterday, then it's going to be pretty tiring for you guys and for anybody presenting in front of you. So it's about needing to open up emotionally a bit more and allow yourself to receive truth. And in fact, one of the things I'd like to raise with you later today is that the majority of you, the main problem you have is you don't want to receive truth. It's a big issue. And every time there's some truth to be received, there's a lot of blockage, emotional blockage. You don't verbalize it, many of you, but you just shut down. It's just like close down. And to me, that's exactly the same as verbalizing it. And to God, it's exactly the same. That's why there's not much of a connection with receiving truth from God for many of you. You just want what you want to be right, to be right. And that's an issue. But let's get started on this discussion, facing my fear of emotion. So yesterday we covered quite a lot of information, didn't we? Three primary areas that we covered were faith, truth, and action, right? Yep. Faith, truth, and action. And now what we'd like to do is focus your attention on emotion. Like, what's the role of emotion in this process? Now, remember that these are, when we're talking about action and we're talking about emotion, both times we were referring to your fear with regard to those particular things. When we talked about faith and when we talked about truth, we were more focused on your resistance, right? Now, most resistance does come from fear, but it also comes from other emotions. So it comes from emotions like arrogance and a desire to hold on to your current lifestyle, your comfort, and a few other things like that. So whereas fear is quite specific sort of emotion, isn't it? Terror or fear, that's a bit more specific in terms of what's going on with your emotion and with your action. So if you think about your resistance to faith and truth, those resistances have many causes, but when it comes to emotion, for the majority of you, the primary feeling is fear of it, wanting to resist it because you're just afraid of it. And you can see this fear in the whole world about emotion, can't you? If anybody's crying, it's like a major disaster if somebody's crying. And most people try, if it's a man, they generally laugh at him or ridicule him. If it's a woman, they try to pacify her and make her calm down, right? So either way, we've got problems with regard to the way in which we address emotion. And yet, love is an emotion. And as we've talked about many times with you, if you're shutting down emotion, you're not able to be as selective as you believe yourself to be able to be. Do you understand what I mean by that? Well, many of you believe that when it comes to emotion, you can be selective. You can choose to feel the happy emotions and at the same time choose to deny the sad, the shame, the guilt, the fear, and other emotions like that. You believe that you're able to be selective. And the irony is that God never made the soul that way. So as soon as you attempt to shut down one type of emotion, All other emotions are also suppressed to a degree or even completely. This is why many of you have experiences where you know you're not really connected to what's going on around you at different times. Because the reality is, for many of you, you're still trying to shut down a group of emotions while at the same time trying to experience life. And you believe that's possible. And in fact, you've been taught that's possible throughout your childhood, through your family of origin, through your school years. You've been taught that it's possible to selectively choose emotion. All right? And then to make matters worse, you also have gone into a lot of emotions of self-delusion. In other words, you think you feel a certain way, and then you choose to feel that way, and it's not even an emotion that you really feel at all. Right? And many of you feel that way with regard to some pure emotions like sincerity, honesty, and those kind of emotions. You often think you're sincere or think you're honest when the reality is the feeling coming out of you is quite the opposite to that. All right. So there's a tendency to even attempt to fool yourself regarding emotions and to be self-delusional regarding emotions. And in fact, in my opinion, many of you are actually quite crazy, right? I mean psychotically crazy, but unfortunately that's the average way of most people on the planet, and so it's acceptable to do this kind of psychotically crazy thing of fabricating a whole heap of emotions in facade while at the same time denying a whole heap of truthful emotions if you were honest with yourself that you would actually feel. But and we're actually taught that this is normal, right? And then somebody who doesn't do that, they're crazy, right? And this is a big problem today. We've got so much judgment of emotion, so much terror of emotion. And it's literal terror for many of you, just terrified of it. Now, a lot of this terror comes from, again, childhood experiences where you had an emotion, and instead of being allowed to completely release that particular emotion, you were either threatened or bribed or punished out of the emotion. Right? And so this is what you now do yourself. You threaten, bribe, or punish yourself for having any emotion. So that causes a lot of judgment. Now, if we look at those primary ways of dealing with emotion, if we look at threats, what does that do? That's basically somebody threatens you. Well, if you have an emotion of some kind, you think of your child, you have an emotion of some kind. So quite often this happened when, as a child, you might have had a bit of a smack by parents. You start crying, and then you really get crying because not only do you hurt from the smack, but also you hurt from the fact that you were smacked oftentimes like with no reason or cause, and that hurts even more then. And so you have a tendency to ham up the emotion a bit, and what do the parents then do? They just say, look, if you're going to do that, I'm going to give you something to really cry about, or something like that, right? Which is a threat, another threat of potential violence. Also, I noticed that many of you live in threat. In other words, the reason why you're hooked into things like Facebook and these kind of social media type things, Twitter, Facebook and those kind of things, is because you're constantly analysing the threat. And you want a whole band of friends to help you mitigate any threat. So instead of just doing what you do in your daily life without needing to publicize it all the time, you need public approval in order to mitigate threats, right? You need public to agree with you. You need your friends to agree with you. You need to have likes, and you need to have, you know, approval of some kind. You need to share your life with the world to know that other people are interested in you, right, rather than dealing with those groups of emotions which cause you to do those particular things. All right? So this is an indication that you're afraid of feeling anything, these kind of behaviours. Then usually what happens is parents also use bribery very much. And in fact, this has become one of the most common methods of controlling children now. Have you noticed that? You know, now it's sort of a bit looked down upon to give the child a smack. So what you do instead is you bribe them with something, right? Whether that be a toy, a lolly, a, you know, some kind of sweetener, if you like, whether it be a real sweet or some other physical thing that they enjoy, and you bribe them into not feeling things. And so many of you are now not only doing that with children, or have done that with your children, but you also do that with yourself. You bribe yourself out of feeling things. You say, oh, I feel a bit low, I need a coffee. There's a bribe, right? Instead of just feeling low and feeling what it's about, you need some kind of injection of something to make the mood change. You know, you feel alone, so what do? You've got to go out. You've got to go and do something rather than just feel lonely. You know, these are, and you're so used to bribing yourself out of how you feel. Does that make sense? You really, it's a manipulation of your own emotion, right? To your own detriment, actually. But most of you believe it's not to your detriment. You also easily respond to the other thing, and that is blackmail. Now, blackmail comes from a bartering system. It's like, you know, the normal bartering system is I give you something, you give me something in return. That's the bartering system, isn't it? All right. Now, blackmail comes from, if you don't give me the something in return, I'm not going to give you the thing I was going to give you. All right. Or I'm only going to give you something in return if you gave me something first. Right. And these kind of blackmail processes, many of you are so used to engaging that you actually think they're loving. Like when somebody doesn't give you something in return, you think, huh, you know, they mustn't care about me. This particularly happens at Christmas time. Have you noticed that? Like any time there's a sort of expected gift-giving process, right? Birthdays, Christmas, those kind of times. This is where your expectations are really just engaging a bartering system rather than love. See, a person who truly loves you will probably want to give you gifts at any time rather than just at one time. And a person who truly cares about you also doesn't give you a gift so they can get something from you. But we're so used to living in that place. And it's a way of manipulating our own emotion. We do it to manipulate others' emotions and our own. All right, so this is the kind of things we do with ourselves. Yeah, with ourselves. It seems like strange, but we've been taught to do that in our childhood, and so now we do it. And whenever we feel or potentially may feel something bad, what we believe is bad, and remember our definition of bad is anything that might be slightly painful, as soon as we have that kind of feeling, we instantly engage a whole set of processes with ourselves in order to get us out of that particular process of feeling bad or pain. Now, the only problem with all that is that we've now become addicted to avoiding pain. And the only problem with that is that that leaves a whole heap of unfelt pain inside of your body, inside of your soul, in fact. And it has an effect both on your spirit and physical bodies. And then on top of that, it causes you to desire to engage addictions, which actually feed the problem more. You believe it makes the problem go away, but actually it feeds it more. And the more you engage the addiction, the sicker the soul becomes. And of course, the sicker the soul becomes, the sicker the body becomes, right? And this is why many of us, as we get older, the older we get, the sicker we get, and the more problems we have. And then before we know it, many now die after 10 years of difficulties with sickness and disease, Because this is what we're doing, engaging all of these processes in order to avoid our emotional condition. You see, if we released our emotions, we wouldn't have these particular issues. But we're not convinced about that. We don't have any faith in that, so we don't do it. And instead, we have faith in what we were taught from a child, and that is, bribe yourself out of it, you know, pleasure yourself out of it, bribe yourself out of it, get out of it somehow. And this is what we do with our emotion. And why do we do all that? Because in the end, we're just addicted to avoiding the emotion. And I think it's pretty sad because the reality is when you're connected emotionally, that's when you know what's going on around you. That's when you can be happy. That's when you're actually aware, you know, actually aware. And also that's when you're actually logical. That's when you make good decisions. Right? And in fact, it's well known when you're playing sports that you've got to be what they call in the zone, right? Which is where the mind is. You've done so much work on technique and all of these other things that you don't need that anymore. And instead of being in your mind, you're now just in your feelings, and you just go by your feelings. And it's well known in the sporting arena that the feelings respond far faster to the decision-making process than the mind can. And that's why it's fascinating watching sports sometimes, isn't it? Because you see these people do some amazing things, and they do it so rapidly and quickly, they haven't even had time to think about what they're doing. And that's why, because they're being taught to actually connect through the feeling-based centres. And anybody who does that knows that that's a far more rapid way of making the best possible decision at that moment. And yet most of us don't do that in our daily life. Yeah, which is an issue. Vera, you had a question.
The physical reflecting the spiritual has been a big thing for me, but I know lots of people who are not in a good condition whose bodies seem to do just fine. What happens with that?
Well, you say that, but if you could see what's going on around them, you might not say that.
Oh, because their lives are crap, but their bodies aren't.
Not only are their lives crap, but also you can see spirits feeding them energy in order to experience what they feel is pleasure, and there's spirits sharing in the energy of that particular person. So, you know, if you look at many of those people and you actually see the spirits, you'd be freaking out about what's going on with them rather than thinking, admiring
them.
Well,
they do freak me out, the people, but I never thought of...
Well, yeah, a lot of the times it's because, you know, they're carrying around a posse of mates who are all experiencing things through them, and they've got this codependent addiction, and the mates supply them energy to keep their body going so that the mates can get the things that they want from the person. It's honestly, if you see the whole picture, there's not a single person I've ever seen.
But I think I've wanted somebody to make me feel better. Why have I not attracted that?
Well, I feel the fact that you're here is an indication that you probably want it to be real rather than not real, wouldn't you? Plus, you are petrified of spirits, so that helps you to avoid them, does it not?
Yeah.
So, I just feel for many of you, this aspect of fear of emotion is a major thing, right? And I find it interesting nowadays that women are just as afraid of emotion as men are. And that hasn't always been the case. But it's very definitely the case now, particularly in the Western world. Yeah, Lani?
I'm finding that I had no idea the level of fear that I'm in.
Yep.
That when I just... do drop into it, like then, like it becomes nauseous. Yep. It just becomes like, wow, this
is. And you've got to go through it.
Yeah, and yep. I'm just realizing I've only just
started.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's probably why I've been so afraid of going there.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had no idea what was underneath it all.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Just an aside. Who has that list of who was here today? Who's meant to be here? You've got it, haven't you? Can you just check who's not here today?
Sure.
Yeah. And let me know afterwards, Eloisa. Thanks. Okay. Sorry. If we come down to Barbara, down in front of you.
Yesterday when we were talking about our worth and all the emotions attached with that,
mm-hmm.
I shut myself down
mm-hmm.
Because there was another extension to that.
Mm-hmm.
With that injury that occurred in me as a child with my worth,
mm-hmm.
I then took a lot of action that now I need to do a lot of repentance for.
Mm-hmm.
And those actions are things like control, feeling superior.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got a great fear of feeling those emotions.
Mm.
So my question on that then, there are things that I have to feel, I have to repent for, but what's the actual emotion I have to feel? Is it going right back to the worthiness or lack of worthiness?
Can you see what you're even doing in the question though, Barb?
No, sorry.
Can anyone help? What's Barb trying to do in this question? If we go across to Kate.
Like asking you to tell her, is it? Instead of investigating it?
Yeah.
Avoid feeling it?
This is what I notice you doing all the time when we have emotional discussions. You know, I don't enjoy emotional discussions with you much anymore. And you know why? Because most of you are trying to predict what your emotion is going to be before you feel it. And you know what that is? That's called control. You're trying to control the process of emotional expression, most of you, right? So your question is an attempt to predict what you have to do before you just repent for your bad behavior. Just repent for your bad behavior. That's all you need to do. And then you'll feel a whole series of emotions. But you don't want to do that without predicting what those emotions may be. You follow? And that is a big problem. Because this is what most of you are attempting to do. You're trying to predict what emotion you will feel before you feel it, right? And then you're not feeling the real emotion when you do that, obviously, right? So how can you expect to grow when you're doing that? The reality is most of you intellectually have no idea what's inside of you. No idea. And because most of you have desensitized yourself emotionally, you also have no idea what it's going to feel like, and you have no idea what other people actually, what's going on inside of them either. You have no idea why you like some people and don't like other people. You have no idea what's going on with any of these particular things because you've desensitized yourself and then you attempt to control every single experience. And every time we have a discussion about emotions, you ask me what your emotion is going to be or may be. Like, why are you asking me? They're your emotions. If you were sensitive, you would feel them. So there's a problem with sensitivity. There's a problem with openness to the actual emotion. There's a problem with being overwhelmed by emotion, isn't there? And this is why you're trying to ask questions before you have an experience. The irony is you're asking all these questions before you have the experience, which actually prevents the experience. The other irony is if you'd just felt the emotion, then you'd know it, the answer to the question, and you wouldn't have to ask somebody. That's why I don't have to ask you what I'm feeling. Does that make sense? And all of these methods emotionally are used to avoid the actual overwhelming experience of having a surprising emotion, you know, something that takes you by surprise, something that's just way out of left field and you can't predict it. But I am going to guarantee to you the majority of you have yet to feel almost all of your emotions because most of them are going to be unpredictable. Most of them are going to be what you believe is out of control. And most of them are are suppressed by you because you're trying to forward guess, forward think yourself into dealing with something, and you're trying to work your way through it that way. And that's not feeling an emotion. That's fear of emotion. Does that make sense?
Which is what the topic's about.
Yeah. Yeah. You fear emotion so much that you want to control its expression, and so you want to ask question after question after question about how do I feel here, what's this emotion, what's that emotion, where's that from, whatever. And we have all these discussions about emotion, but the reality is we're having the discussions because you don't want to feel them. So what's the point of the discussion? The point of the discussion is really so that you don't have to feel out of control and feel an emotion on your own back without having any reassurance and without having anybody being positive around you and say, you beauty, and without anybody saying to you, that's the right one, and you just go ahead and you do it. You see? That's what you're trying to prevent. Because that place to you is crazy. It's unstable. That's where you worry about your own sanity. And yet that's the place that the majority of you need to go at some point. And you haven't. And that's why very few of you have made any real progress when it comes to God's truth. Because the majority are still doing this. You're still trying to guess and predict and control your emotional experience. You're so worried about the psychological effect of feeling crazy, right, that you actually have become crazy. Because you're manufacturing all of these different things and you're predicting them and you're trying to guess them and all that. And that's the actions of a crazy person. It's like running around trying to do all of these things just to stop and experience that. If you just allowed it to happen, it would be over maybe in a day or two and you'd be done. And yet we go on for years like this, year after year after year after year. Many of you have been listening 6 years and there's no real progress being made because you haven't allowed yourself to really feel one emotion. And if you just felt one, you'd at least get a little bit of momentum and go, wow, that's a powerful experience. Maybe another one would be good, you know, on a different subject or whatever. Yeah. Okay. So you've got to be very careful of that, Barb. Every time we discuss emotions, many of you do this with me. And while I can feel what your emotions are, that doesn't help you feel them. All it helps you do is experience your fear of them, because now you needed somebody else to reassure you that it's all right to feel it. Now you need to go through the experience yourself, so without anybody giving you this reassurance, so that in the end of it you are confident within yourself that you can cope with any emotion. And once you become confident inside of you that you can cope and deal with any emotion, then you'll allow emotion without trying to predict and guess and bribe yourself out of them or get your addictions met instead. You see? Then the emotions will naturally flow.
Right. So I'm going to start with repentance.
Start with what you... Every time you talk about repentance, you start tearing up.
Yeah.
And then you ask, what's the emotion I have to feel? Well, no, just repent and see where it takes you. You'll soon see what were the reasons why you chose to take some of these actions if you go through the process. You don't have to do as much guessing as what most of you are attempting to do. And to be honest, most of you are guessing badly. Well, can you see why? Remember yesterday and 2 days earlier, we drew that diagram where you have your soul-based feelings and then you have your mind. And what's the mind really doing? It's just responding to what the soul wants it to respond to, right? So when you guess, what do you think is happening? Your soul is actually trying to get you to guess wrong, because you don't want to process the emotion. That's the feeling in the soul. I don't want to process emotion, so it's in my interest to guess wrong under those circumstances. You see? And that's why most of you guess wrong, because your mind is just doing what the soul wants, and the soul wants avoidance. So the mind goes, okay, what can we do to avoid the actual problem? Oh, we just create a whole heap of other things that don't even exist to avoid that problem. We create a whole heap of fictitious, self-delusional states in order to avoid the truth about what's really going on. You follow? And this is what I notice most of you doing. Yep. And particularly that group of ladies that I've mentioned who've been listening for 6 years and haven't changed. You know, you're all doing that. You're all maintaining this place. So it's time to switch that over and change that around, right? Yep. Linda, thanks. Over here, if you leave your hand up.
AJ, I feel that when I started this process, I was much better at allowing the emotion to just take me where it needed to go. Uh-huh. And I feel now that I'm actually quite controlling of it at times.
Yeah, no, I agree.
But I don't understand why that is.
I feel, Linda, you don't want to come face to face with the truth about yourself. And so what's happened is initially you were allowed to you allowed yourself to process some emotions because initially what happens is we're quite enthusiastic, we feel like, yes, I'd like to receive some of God's love, and so we're quite, you know, desirous of doing that, and so we realize we've got to feel some emotions, so we allow ourselves to feel some. But then what happens is some of them get pretty painful, right? Right, and we have one or two of those painful experiences, and then we realize actually that we've got a huge block to feeling real painful experiences emotionally. And so what we try to do then is backpedal. We're trying to avoid the emotion rather than to get into the emotion. So most of you have had an emotional experience or two because you've allowed at the beginning that enthusiasm to carry through into affecting your allowance of emotion. But over time, I'm talking a larger amount of time now, we were 5, 6, 7, 8 years. Over time, after a few of those experiences, generally most people get into this really stuck place because they don't want to go to the step of having these really full-on emotional experiences. And as a result of that, they backpedal and try to close the process down.
So for me, the process... where I need to focus really is on developing faith and trust in God's process, isn't it?
And that God built you.
And then taking action.
Yeah, God built you to process emotion. God built you to release it. And we need to have a lot of faith in that, that God built us to do it. Like, most of you have no trust of that at all. In fact, many of you would rather die than feel emotion at this stage. You'd rather die than feel emotion, right?
So is it just to keep praying about it and keep stepping into it? It's keep taking that action towards
it?
Yeah,
I feel too also, but we've talked yesterday about faith. You know, we need to build faith. We need to stop avoiding faith. Yeah. Remember, we avoid faith by choice so that we're not motivated. Yeah. We need to stop avoiding truth because we avoid truth by choice. Yeah. And we need to stop avoiding action because we avoid action by choice. So this is where what we're trying to get at with you is to show you that actually, no, what most of us are doing is using our will. We're making choices daily to avoid developing faith, avoid acknowledging truth, and avoid taking action. Now, if we do all of those things, it's highly unlikely we'll feel any emotion. You follow? But on top of that, we do that to avoid feeling emotion. Yeah. That's our underlying motivation for taking these actions. So that's something we need to choose to reverse. Yeah. And this is where I feel a lot of work needs to be done if you want to use your will properly. We need to get back to developing faith in God, developing faith in truth as well, like wanting truth rather than feeling, you know, having this worth connection with our truth. Every time we hear the truth about ourselves, we destroy it emotionally because of our worth connections with truth. You know, from God's perspective, he just wants to share truth with us. He doesn't want to destroy your worth. He wants to give you worth, but not a fictitious one, not a fake one, not one that's been maintained by some facade that you have. And so God wants us to make this change into reality, which most of us are avoiding because we want our reality. We want the mirror to show a whole lot of things that the mirror doesn't really show, right? God's mirror certainly wouldn't show it. And so what we do is we go, okay, it's like looking into the mirror and then deciding, yeah, I've got all these blemishes, hey? So what I'll do is I'll paint a picture on the mirror. So every time I look in the mirror, that's what I see. And I go, oh, I look pretty good.
Thank you.
You know, that's what we do. Yeah, Sherry, thanks.
Um, So I feel terrified of feeling emotions, and
I don't know if I agree with that, Sherry, but come on with your question.
Well, just recently I got diagnosed with an autoimmune disease, because, and what I noticed is that the feelings that I had, like, were a lot of fear type feelings in my body. So I sort of saw, like, okay, there's terror here that I don't want to feel. And then I got afraid.
Yeah, see, when you say I'm terrified of feeling emotions, I feel many of you need to be a bit more specific, because there's certain emotions you're not terrified of feeling. For example, you feel anger very regularly and you're not terrified of it at all. You're quite expressive with that one.
Yes.
So the reality is you're not terrified of all emotion, you're only terrified of certain kinds of emotion.
Okay.
And I feel you need, you know, rather than having a blanket where you know, it's like shaking, getting a bed and chucking a blanket over all the rubbish that's on top of it and going, oh, there's a blanket on the bed, but actually if you look underneath, there's a whole heap of other things on the bed as well that you haven't examined, right? And this is what I see you doing with emotion. You sort of have a blanket thing which is throw over it and call it all fear. But the reality is that all of it is a lot of different types of emotion, some of which you're afraid of and some of which you're perfectly happy to express.
Okay.
All right?
Yep.
Yep. And it needs a lot more self-honesty to determine which emotion I'm happy to express. So I'm happy with anger. So you're okay with anger?
Yep.
Right, so it's something you express with Steve fairly regularly, and it's something you feel fairly regularly. So you're okay feeling anger. So you're not afraid of anger. Other people are afraid of anger.
Yeah.
But you're not afraid of anger. So there's an emotion you're not afraid of.
Okay.
So what emotions are you actually afraid of?
Like fear and or terror and grief.
So terror and grief?
Yeah, I think I probably don't want to feel shame.
Yeah, I feel it's more terror and shame.
Yeah, okay.
But anyway.
Yeah.
That's something you'll need to determine in your own feelings. They are the feelings I feel from you. Yeah. The reason why you get so angry is actually you're quite ashamed of yourself, and you want to protect that shame at all costs. And that shame to you is much bigger motivator than preventing sadness, for example.
Okay, yeah.
You follow?
Yeah. So can I ask a little bit more?
Sorry?
Can I ask a little bit more?
No, because you're asking personal questions and I'd like to get on to the actual subject and we'll do the Q&A afterwards and then
okay.
we Thank can you. Do that. Is that all right?
Thanks.
Yep. So one thing I wanted to share with you is about fear. In fact, it's not me that wanted to share, it's Mary. So I'll just read some of her notes about this that she wanted to tell you. She wanted to help you contrast the road of fear with the road of, like, having less, you know, not honouring fear. So the road where you honour fear, what happens, and the road where you don't honour fear and what happens. And what she wanted to do is to contrast for you the different types of things that happen when you honour fear in comparison to not honouring fear. Does that make sense? Okay, so this is what she's written down. She says, when we use our will to avoid fear, our life becomes routine and predictable. Right? Now, many of you have a routine and predictable life as a result of that. Whereas when you don't honor fear, there's opportunities everywhere. You could be making choices and decisions to do all sorts of things in a place where you're not honoring fear. Right. So these are just some contrasts for you that she's written down. Life's unpredictable and invigorating when you no longer respond to fear. But when you respond to fear, it feels more predictable. Often life feels restricted or confined or limited or hopeless when you honour your fear. When you don't honour fear, you're always learning. Your perspective and understandings are always changing and expanding. You change. In fact, many times daily. Like yesterday, completely, I feel differently about one thing compared to the day before. Does that make sense? And you're constantly changing in terms of even your attitudes. When you live in fear, you end up doing what other people want. Or you end up doing what you want to maintain comfort. Right? When you're not in fear, your personality and your desires are expressed exactly as you are. Right? When you are in fear, you're dependent upon others for happiness. This is a big problem for many of you, particularly many of you ladies. Whereas when you're not in fear and you're allowing yourself to not act in fear, you feel alive, you want to take action, you want to make decisions, you want to do things that are different. When you are in fear, there's no growth. And in fact, frequently there's regression. Right? Whereas when you are not in fear, there's constant growth. Now, most of you have no idea what constant growth even is at this point, because you're in this no growth period of your life where you're not challenging things. When you are in fear, the fears seem to get worse the older you get. Isn't that true? All right, so, you know, when you're 30, you might think of doing something, and then when you're 40, you look back at 30 and go, I don't know how I did that. I don't feel like doing that anymore. And you tell yourself even that it was stupid that you did that, rather than just seeing that it was a fear that's causing you to feel that way. Right? Fears, they grow and they seem to become insurmountable. When you're living in fear, you seem to have or not be able to connect to your real desires. In other words, you can't even recognize what they might be, you know. And this is where you start asking other people, you know, what do you think of my desires? That's a pretty pointless question to ask people, isn't it? You'd be surprised how many times I get asked that question. You know, I reckon there, almost every group I've ever been to, I've been asked that question at least once. So I've been to 1,400 groups at this point. So it means I've been asked that at least 1,400 times in the last 8 years. All right, it's a lot of times, isn't it? Someone coming up and want me to tell them what their desires are. When you're in fear, you're always trying to find ways to distract yourself from the truth. You don't feel connected or any actual satisfaction. In fact, it's very, very hard to feel any positive joy at all in that place. Okay, so that's the kind of things we do when we're on a fear. So Mary made up that list because she's been going through a lot of those particular things now. So why do we do this with our emotion? Well, there's a lot of reasons really, isn't there? Firstly, as we've discussed, the soul has a desire to avoid pain. And while the soul wants that desire to be met, then the mind is just going to come up with a whole heap of fabrications, including a whole heap of lies, which, remember, fear is like, remember yesterday we learned that my truth is really fear, which are really false expectations appearing real. So that really means they are lies from God's perspective. That's why they're sin, you see, because fear is lies, right? When you're one with God, you don't have any fear. So outside of that, every time you're afraid of something, you're just telling yourself lies all the time. And I'm talking in particular about our emotional fears, not our physical ones. You know, it's wise for you to not consider jumping off a 20-story building, right? Because obviously there's a law involved there that's going to result in some hurt. But for many of you, you see just walking down the road or going shopping or going overseas or getting up in front of a group of people and talking about God's truth or, you know, or just somebody thinking that you're a bad person as jumping off of a building would be preferable to you many, many times. So we've got to remember that basically what we're doing is just telling ourselves lies. Every time we honour the fear that we have within us, particularly our emotional fears and particularly our fears about experiencing emotion, we're just honouring lies. That's all we're doing. That's how we make fear our God. We just honor a whole heap of lies from God's perspective. From God's perspective, you are totally capable of addressing every single emotion. You're totally capable of experiencing every single one, and you're totally capable of taking action so that you do so. That's God's feelings. And in fact, God even takes it further and says, no, you are personally responsible for all of your feelings. They're in you now. No matter who caused them, no matter who triggered them, no matter what happened to you when you're a child, they're in you now. Does that make sense? There's nothing you can do about them being in you aside from letting them out of you. You can't remove them from your childhood. That experience is already gone. It's already happened. The only thing you can do is do something about them now, right? And God does expect you to do something about them now. Now, God will give you lots of help to do it. And this is part of coming to trust God. Many of you can't trust God yet because you've yet to fully experience a single emotion and therefore yet to know what it's like to go through that experience and therefore yet to know what it's like to fully trust that God made you to go through that experience and to fully trust God helps you through that experience, right? So that's an issue. So what happens then is you think you're alone processing emotion, right? And you believe you're alone before you even begin. And the reality is, in your childhood, you certainly were probably alone whenever it came to feeling emotion. Like the majority of families do not support the feeling or expression of emotion in children, particularly when those emotions are in disharmony or disagreement with the parents themselves, with the parents' own emotion. And so the majority of families don't support you feeling emotion, but God does. And so what we end up doing is we grow up believing that no one's going to support us feeling an emotion. And the reality is we then want all sorts of things to help us emotionally. This is why antidepressants are one of the major pharmaceutical manufacturers' dreams at the moment, because half the population is on them, particularly half the Western population. And the reason why is because most of us want to avoid any negative, what we believe is any negative or painful emotion. We'd rather take a pill and be numb to all emotion through that taking of a pill and numb to all desire and numb, like it, many of these drugs do cause that. And yeah, we're happier doing that so that we can feel stable emotionally. So it's a major problem on this planet, this fear of emotion. A major problem. And the interesting thing is once you get through it, you know you can deal with anything, right? You know you can handle anything that comes your way. And, you think about it, that gives you a lot of confidence, doesn't it? If you knew that, it would give you a lot of confidence about your future. If you knew that you can handle anything, and particularly with God's help, you can handle everything, right? But most of us don't even get to trust God to that limit, to that length, because we're so stuck on this concept that we have that we've got to avoid emotional pain at all costs. So the soul, how do we get the soul away from thinking that it has to avoid all pain? It's obviously a feeling in our soul. We've got to do something, don't we, to have this soul change inside of us so that we're no longer wishing to avoid pain. Now, what usually naturally happens is that the pain builds and pain builds and pain builds and pain builds until the pain, we no longer can cope with the emotional pain itself, and then we surrender. That's normally the process that happens. It doesn't have to happen that way, but that's normally the process that happens. So you remember when we channeled verses like Glenn, he said he went through this place where he's numb for years and years, and then he became frustrated and angry, and he'd get exhausted going through that process as well. And eventually he got to just surrender to some tears once. because the pain of where he was at up until that point was so bad that he just finished up surrendering to his tears. And then he realized that's when he made some real shift. Right? Now that is how the average person gets to feel emotion. Now for many of you, even after this discussion, it's going to be after you've died that you'll go through that experience, because you're not choosing to go through it now and you're still in a lot of resistance to choosing it. You follow? What I would like to see is that you don't wait till then, but you go through it now. You go through the experience now. But most of you don't want to. And this is an issue of your will. So the alternative then, what's the alternative to that? So that's the way it happens for pretty much most people. That's the way it happened for me, to be frank. Like, I got to a point where everything in my life was pretty much destroyed, right? And I had a choice of either dying or deciding to change, right? And then I decided, well, you know, if it was up to me and I probably didn't have children, I probably would have chose to die. That's how much I was avoiding my emotions. But because I had two boys, I decided, well, I can't die and leave them with the thought of that they might be partially responsible for my death, right? So I had to do something about it so that I could live, and that meant choosing to live properly. And so I had to make a different choice. And the moment I made a different choice, I started taking action. I went to do body work therapy so that I'd release some emotion. And every time I went there, I'd be allowance of the emotion, and the emotion would release. So I got a bit of help initially, so I couldn't fool myself with my mind and tell myself what things were. And the body work helped me get through that process. And then once I got to the point where I was no longer fooling myself with my mind about what was really inside of me, then the stuff just started coming out by myself. I didn't need anybody else after that doing that for me. You follow? And the question becomes, well, when are you going to do it? Well, are you going to wait like I did until your whole life's pretty much a mess? And for many of you, that with the level of control you have currently of your life, that probably isn't going to happen until after you die. Does that make sense? With the level of control you currently exert over your current life, it's probably unlikely for many of you that you'll go through my experience, because many of you have your life under a semblance of control. And you probably, given the fact that most of you still desire this control, are probably going to maintain that control until you pass. But after you pass, you're going to find that you've got far less control over all of your life. Right? So that's one option. What's the other option? Yeah, the other option obviously is to help do everything you possibly can. Right now, from now on, do everything you possibly can to help your soul change this decision it's made. Can you see? That's the problem. The problem is the decision to avoid pain at all costs. That's the decision we've made. And we need to do things to engage a process that will help the soul get beyond that point, right? And there's all sorts of things you can do that. You can, by educating yourself, reading things, like reading about emotion, reading about emotional experiences, how healing occurs, and so forth. And you can, you know, so many things that you could do. I don't know, during that phase I read so many books. I can't even remember how many of them there are now, because I read one every day or two, like for nearly 2 years, of all about emotions and emotional expression, emotional experience, feeling your desires and passions and all those kind of things. And I got to the point where I was convinced internally that the right thing to do was to experience my pain rather than avoid it. I had to educate myself. And this is what I feel you need to do. You need to educate yourself so that this particular attitude of the soul no longer exists inside of you. avoid pain at all costs, which is the current attitude that is inside the majority of you, that is the attitude that needs to change. If that attitude changes and all of a sudden you're feeling like, wow, I can experience pain and pain is going to, experiencing my pain will heal me, and you're convinced about that in your heart, can you see that's going to change quite a lot of things in terms of how you experience emotion, isn't it? Yeah, so Lani?
So is what you're saying, is that like you read so many books and you just sort of overwhelmed yourself with all this desire to do this so that...
No, my feelings are desire grows over a period of time based on what you educate yourself on. Do you follow what I mean by that?
Yeah.
So if I educate myself in the truth and about how God made the human soul, then eventually I'll come to see how important dealing with my emotions are. Now, if I don't do that education, I will come to convince myself that emotions are completely unnecessary in order to have a connection with God. And as soon as you get to that point, you're lost.
Yeah.
Right, and there's many people I've talked to in the last 8 years who are now lost because they believe that emotional processing is unnecessary. Right,
yeah.
And I'm saying to you, no, sorry, love is an emotion. It has to flow for you to feel it, and you won't feel love flow unless you can feel all of your emotions flow. So it's a very important thing to choose to do to get away from this cycle of just avoiding pain and avoiding past pain even. The majority of us are not even just choosing to avoid our current, you know, situations that may cause pain. We're avoiding our pain from when we were 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, all those formative year pain that occurred, most of us are choosing to avoid it, right? And that underlying choice that we're making at the soul level can only be triggered by two things. One is that your life gets so terrible that and so out of control that you finish up dealing with it. Now, as I say, if the majority of you leave that decision to when that happens, that'll be after you've passed, right? And that's why for the majority of people, it is after they've passed. That decision is made. The second choice is educate your soul differently. Allow yourself to see the importance of letting go of past pain and the healing effect of it. Look at all of the studies that have been done about it, all of the different, you know, there's been thousands of studies on this planet about it. Right, there's studies on cancer, for example, where they've realized that if they process anger and childhood resentment, that there's a doctor in Germany who heals 90% of cancer without actually giving them any drugs at all, and all he does is help them go through the rage and resentment and the addiction-based interactions they have with their family members. That's all he does. And you look at these studies and in the end you'll be convinced, right? You'll be convinced that avoiding pain is actually detrimental to your health.
So this really needs to be number one priority and to, you know, in our lives if we really want to change.
I don't think it needs to be number one, no. Right? Number one is faith. Number two, truth. Number three, take action. Number four, let yourself feel your emotion. You follow? But without feeling your emotion, no change is possible. Just like without receiving truth, no change is possible. Without having faith, no change is possible. And without taking actions, no change is possible. Right. So these are, I feel, the four things collectively will help you engage your will for positive change. Yep. Ruma, thanks.
Hi, I feel I've been educating myself on avoiding pain and actually had some positive experience regarding some emotions, but still, I know that I've been deceiving myself with some emotions that I were not able...
Can I stop you all from asking these personal questions? because the chance to do that is in our Q&A. I want your questions to be about the subject matter we're discussing. Can we can we focus it on like that? Thanks. Kathy, down to Kathy.
I think I'm getting a little bit confused about when somebody's about to suicide, aren't they feeling extreme like emotions all up?
No, they're feeling rage. When someone is about to suicide, they're feeling rage. That's what I was feeling when I was about to suicide. I felt angry with the world, angry with how my life's turned out, angry that no one cared about me. So I just thought, might as well end it. Once you start feeling the anger, then you realise actually, I just want to take it out on people. And in my case, I couldn't take it out on my sons. So I decided, well, no, that's not the way to go. You follow me? It's usually anger that causes a person to suicide. That's why most suicides in the world are young men, because a lot of them are very angry and they don't know how to deal with their anger, and they want to project it out at the world, and that's why the majority of them finish up suiciding. This is also why the majority of people suicide after an event that's occurred in their life that's caused them to be disappointed with the outcome of their life, for the same reason. They're angry about it, and they just don't want to feel their anger about it. Yeah. Depression is also the result of anger, suppressed. So the way a man handles his unfelt rage about the world and what's happened to him is by shooting himself. The way a woman does it is by suppressing rage. And so she gets depressed, and that's why there are 6 times more women using antidepressants than men. Because women usually don't kill themselves, but rather they suppress their rage. They're really angry, don't want to experience it, suppress their rage, and become depressed as a result. Ludi, thank you.
I've heard you talk in the past about the way to want to feel emotions is to remove the emotions you have about feeling emotions, you know, the childhood emotions. So that's
isn't this one? This is the biggest one.
Yeah. So that's like a thing to do coupled with the education.
What is the antidote to fear? We've talked about fear all the time. What's the antidote? Truth. So how do you change an inbuilt internal feeling that you have that something is true when it's false? The only way you can do that is by educating yourself in something that is true. And so this is the importance of truth in your life. And this is where I spent a lot of time during that period of time when I was, and I wasn't focused on God at this stage. Like, this is like, you know, years before that. And what I did was focused on, okay, I've got some pretty big emotions here, obviously, that I need to address and deal with. And how? What am I going to do with them? Am I going to die or deal with them? What am I going to do? And then it occurred to me that the only way I could really process through things is by educating myself about what the truth is. It's no good relying on somebody telling you that emotions are good for you when they're actually bad for you. If that was the case. So what I had to do first is find out whether they are good for you or not. You know what? And of course it helped, because I was pretty numb. It helped whenever I felt an emotion, I no longer felt numb, and that helped greatly to work out, well, actually this is quite good. I remember the very first time I ever felt happy my whole life. I was driving a car down to see a guy who did some body therapy for me, and I'd been doing that for nearly 3 months. And I was driving down and I felt like, I'm really connected here and I feel really good. I feel happy. First time I ever felt happy. And I was 36, right? So it's very important that you educate yourself truthfully about emotion, right? The problem is there is so much research about it on this planet, and none of you really want to look at it because nobody really wants to look at it, because the reason why is because we're all afraid of emotion and we want to maintain the fear of emotion rather than feel it. That's our problem. So we've got to make a different choice to get beyond that. And it has to be a choice that motivates you into some kind of action, So it has to come, you know, usually a choice that motivates you into action through desire has to come from within your heart or your soul, otherwise you wouldn't do it. So it's no good me just telling you to do it. You need to decide for yourself to take that action. But it's interesting, in the last 6 years you've been hearing Divine Truth, you've heard me many times state about emotion and its importance in terms of processing. You've heard me also many times state that I've had to work through many emotions and I had to learn about dealing with emotions, and yet very few of you have taken any time to educate yourself about emotion, which tells me that the majority of you just want to ignore that facet of God's truth. You follow? Yeah.
Thanks.
Barbara, thanks.
While you've been talking about that, I was sitting here asking the question about educating myself on emotions, and I was given a lot of flashes about faith, that in my life already I've dealt with. And it showed me some of the emotions on a very small scale that I've dealt with. Hmm. And I've kept those all separate and not ever put them together to build enough faith.
Correct. We frequently do this. This is a big problem we have. Many of you have processed some emotion, right? Particularly the emotions that your soul has allowed you to process, because it feels it's not too painful to do. And many of you have done that, but you're not adding all of those experiences up and helping them motivate your faith to do the next experience. Yeah, and I've found that very essential for my progression.
Yeah, well, I was just shown that very well.
Yeah, to keep reminding myself that every time I've done this in the past, it's always benefited me, so that's what I need to do in the future as well. Right? No matter how frightened I am of whatever it is I need to experience. Yeah. Okay, so the main point I wanted to get at here is, again, we use fear as an excuse to not change the way in which we deal with emotion. We use fear as a motivation to control the expression of emotion rather than actually examining this underlying soul reason why we want to avoid emotion, which is basically we just want to avoid all emotional pain, right? Not understanding that while this pain is within us, it continues to kill us. Like, so it's going to finish up killing your physical body if you leave it inside of you. But not only that, it destroys you internally. It destroys your soul, because it's all this baggage that you're carrying along and making decisions upon every single day of your life. And something has to change in order for that to occur. And the change has to come from within the soul, and that change has to be that we no longer wish to avoid pain, because we know that pain, feeling some pain and letting it go, is good for us. And we need to become convinced that that is true. So it doesn't matter if Jesus or whoever tells you that, inside of yourself, unless you become convinced that that is true, you will not do it. You will not. There has to be a conviction inside of you that that is true. And I can guarantee to you that if you don't do it, you have no chance of ever becoming at one with God. None at all. No matter what anybody else wants to tell you, you have no chance. Because God's love is an emotion. When it flows through you, it's going to trigger emotion, and unless you're prepared to experience it, you will not progress. You can't. That make sense? Yep. So what I'd like to do is leave that discussion there now, and what we'll do is we have a short break, if we can just have a maybe 5 to 10 minute break, and then we'll come back and we'll do the Q&A on emotion and the Q&A on action together.